congressman representing the 7th District of Georgia, Mr. Rob Woodall. And just to let you know, he is going to be speaking with us for about an hour. And one of the things that he's going to focus on, obviously, are the roles that he has to play in Washington and the committees that he's on. And he's in one of the most powerful committees in Washington, which is the House Rules Committee. And obviously, he'll be explaining his roles in Washington, but hopefully he'll be able to touch upon the importance of that committee as it pertains to parties and the kinds of legislation that is going to be introduced throughout the year at both sessions of Congress. So at this time, I'd like to introduce you to Representative Rob Woodall, 7th District.
Thank you, Mr. You guys are actually doing me the favor by letting me come by, but am I doing anybody else a favor? Was there a bad test or anything going on that you got to get out of to be here? It's supposed to be a partnership that we're in, and I say that to you sincerely. If I can start by identifying who my bosses are in the room, who's 18 and thinking about voting on Tuesday? A couple folks. I just want to check, because you know you don't get registered automatically. You got to go and make that effort. You had to actually do it by the first week of October. Who knows with certainty that they're registered? Who knows with certainty that they're registered? If I keep those hands up for just a second, who also knows with certainty that they really could care less about what happens on November 4th, and so they are not going to go and cast a vote? Who's certain that their vote does not matter and they don't care and they're not going to go? Come on. Really? That's good news. That is good news. What surprises me, and maybe you guys would think it's is exactly what you would expect, but if you're 18 to 22 years old, you're the least likely in America to turn out and vote. You may have seen those numbers, which is weird, because if I screw it up there, it's all on you. I mean, have you thought about that? I mean, I tell folks I'm closer to death than I am to birth. I'm going to get out of this thing okay. Don't worry about me. I'm going to be fine. But you guys, right? I mean, if we get it right, you get to benefit from that for the next 80 years. And if we screw it up, you have to bear the burden of that for the next 80 years. And yet folks don't show up and vote. Of those people who are 18, how many of you believe that you're the boss of me? And if you picked up the phone and gave me some advice, that I'd be apt to take it. Who believes they're the boss of me? Really? Nobody? Because, you know, your teachers here, you're not the boss of them, right? Your parents, you're not the boss of them. But you really are the boss of me. And here's the deal that I want to make with you this morning. And I mean this sincerely. You tell me what it is that you think the future of America ought to look like. I've got some ideas of my own. But I want to know what you think the future of America ought to look like. And 9 times out of 10, I'll vote your way. Give you an example. Anybody worried about how they're going to pay for college? Anybody have financing on their mind? Miss, your hand came up fast. Are you really worried about what's going to go on here? Where are the UGA thing? Isn't the Hope Scholarship going to take care of you? Yes, you're the first hand up. Hope Scholarship's going to solve all your woes. Are you going to go to Georgia? Is that on the list? It's not on the list. Where are you going to go? Oh, man. I don't understand how big Georgia brains can leave us and go out of state when we would send you for free. Oh, man. Get you a foundation fellow scholarship down at UGA, foreign study grants, all those things. Leaving us for baby blue. Carolina blue. We can do two things for you for college financing. I want you to think about it, because again, it doesn't matter to me. What I want is for you to be successful. We can't succeed as a country unless you maximize your potential. If you're operating at 85%, 90%, that's not going to be good enough. We need 100%. There are those folks in Washington who believe that the best way to love on you and make you successful is to create a giant pot of money and tell you can borrow all the money you want to so you can go to any school in the United States of America that's going to best serve your needs. Right? Anybody thinking about taking out some of those student loans that we're going to guarantee for you? I took them out. I felt rich the first day that check came in. Thank you for confessing, Miss. You're not going to be rich the first day that check comes in. Don't go out and do something crazy with it. But there's another group in Washington that says, hey, wait a minute. We've been trying the student loan thing for a long, long time, but there's some other things we could do. What if we funded a co-op program instead? You guys know what a co-op program is? Where you go to school for a semester, work for a semester, school for a semester, work for a semester. It takes you about 50% longer to get through school because you end up going summers too. But you end up building a relationship with an employer. You end up developing some real-world job skills on day on day one. And so when you come out of school, you have an employer who loves you, you have a skill set that's valuable, and your employment opportunities look different. Anybody think about working their way through college, working on the grounds crew, working in the cafeteria? Sir, you've looked at the dollars and cents, and you know working your way through is the way that's going to happen? You think you're going to be able to get out debt-free? You think you're going to have to borrow some money anyway? Yeah. But so you tell me, because this is an actual discussion that happens on Capitol Hill. Folks who love you want you to borrow as much money as you possibly can so you can go anywhere in the country you want to go to fulfill your dreams. Or folks who want to put you to work your way through school. It's going to take you longer. It's going to be a whole lot harder, but you're going to graduate debt-free and with a different skill set than you would have otherwise. Which crowd loves you more? Is it obvious to you? Whether it's the loan crowd or the co-op work study crowd that loves you more? It's not obvious to me. I don't know. I see kids graduate with $250,000 in loans and no jobs, and I'm thinking, we did not do those kids a favor. Didn't do them a favor. I see other folks who are going to work their way through school, and they really would have liked to have gone Ivy League, but they couldn't afford it, and so they did something else, and I worry, did we really help them to maximize their potential? I'm not sure there are right answers to 90% of the questions that I vote on with your parents' voting card and your voting card in Washington, D.C., but I am certain that we come to better answers when folks are involved in the process. Anybody ever told you that America is run by 51% of Americans, right? Greatest democracy in the world. Not the largest democracy. Our friends in India are the largest democracy in the world, but we're the greatest democracy in the world. It is nonsense that this country is run by 51% of Americans. It's just not true. I don't know if there are any conspiracy theorists here who think it's run by a couple of big families who are pulling all the strings. I've seen some of those movies out there. That's not true either. But it's not run by 51% of Americans. It's run by the 51% of Americans who care enough to show up. Who care enough to show up. In the primary election we had earlier this year, that number was 18% of Georgians. 18% of Georgians cared enough to show up and have their voice heard. And here's the dirty little secret about where we live, you and I. November elections don't much matter for making decisions. For 90% of the offices that you get a chance to vote for, you're going to have a really tough time getting rid of me in November. Because the district is just a Republican district. I'm a Republican, makes it hard for a Democrat to win. Now, the same thing would be true down in Fulton County, right? You're not going to be able to get rid of John Lewis in November either. John Lewis, civil rights hero, great American, believes different things about the future of the country than I do, but you can't get rid of him in November either. You've got to do those things in the primary when only 18% of the country, 18% of the state cared enough to show up. I am optimistic about the future of the country. I'm absolutely certain that the best days lie ahead, but I am concerned that if you don't believe that too, and if you don't believe that you're the boss, and if you don't believe you have an obligation as a member of the Board of Directors of the United States of America to show up and make those things happen, I worry about what those outcomes can be. Tell you one story, then I'm going to talk about what you want to talk about. I don't know if you think much about our national debt. I think a lot about it. I sit on the budget committee too. I introduced the budget, wrote the budget that is the one that balances the fastest in Washington, D.C. It still took me 4 years. Couldn't make enough tough decisions to get there any faster. We couldn't get enough votes to pass. We ended up passing the Paul Ryan budget. He's my chairman on the budget committee. His budget balanced in 10 years. We got enough votes to pass that in the House. We've borrowed about $18 trillion from him. About $18 trillion. I think you're good for it. But I don't know if you've thought about what $1 trillion looks like. Any entrepreneurs here, anybody who's not going to go to work for the man, you're going to hang out your own shingle and do it your own way, you don't care what anybody else says, thank you, miss, for not going to work for the man. Do you know what it is that you want to do? Do you know how you're going to hang out your own shingle? Do you really? Good for you. Good for you. A whole different story about how individual passion creates better results than some of our government grant programs. But that's not really a profit business, right? Just talk about dealing with orphaned children and trying to help folks be successful. That's not really a for-profit industry, right? That's a labor of love that you do. In fact, it's going to cost you some money to get that done. Let's say that you started that effort on the day that Jesus Christ was born. Let's say you started in 0 AD, okay? And you spent $1 million your very first day trying to help kids and help kids succeed. but it wasn't enough. So you spent $1 million your second day too. Let's say you're a hard worker, you're working 7 days a week. You spent $1 million a day, 7 days a week, from zero AD through today, trying to help children achieve a better future. You would have to continue to spend $1 million a day, every day, 7 days a week, for another 733 years to have invested your first $1 trillion in those children. Another 733 years to have spent your first $1 trillion making a difference in people's lives. We have borrowed and spent from you $18 trillion, and it's gone forever. We can't get it back. You can decide whether we invested that wisely in you or whether we threw it down a rat hole, but it's gone. $18 trillion, which is why I say your voice matters. Folks are willing. We feel a good bit of guilt about having done that to you. Why I say your opinion matters and folks are willing to do what you share with them, you believe the best future of the country would be. Anybody have an idea on your mind? I was telling your teachers earlier, I'd be happy to take credit for your good ideas and run with them. Anybody have an idea? They think, you know what, if we really wanted to make America better, if we wanted to make our community better, if we really wanted to be more successful as a group, this is something we would do. Anybody have a game-changing idea? Come on. Best and the brightest that Forsyth County has to offer, I've got to believe, game-changing idea. Sir, you think he's got one and he just doesn't want to share it? Sir, why are you keeping it a secret? Why won't you share it? So we'll get you a patent, we'll get you a copyright, we won't really steal your idea. I just want to try to help you get some attention for it. Nothing on your list? Man alive. Cut the minimum wage to bring more jobs back to America. Anybody working right now who's getting a paycheck? Thank you for sending in those taxes every Friday afternoon. I appreciate that. Have you really studied it to see what you're paying? 15.3% for Medicare and Social Security. There's a poll out the other day that said more people in your age bracket believe they'd see a UFO in their lifetime than see a Social Security check in their lifetime. I don't know where you all are on that issue. 15.3% of every dollar you earn sucked out before you even see it. That's before we go and take income taxes and state and local taxes. But gentlemen's talking about the minimum wage. Tell me your name, sir. Malad. What do you think about Malad's idea? Is let's lower the minimum wage. If we lower the minimum wage, we'll get more job creation. What do you think? Do you think that higher minimum wage, lower minimum wage? Where do my folks you think we ought to raise the minimum wage? $7.25 an hour right now at the federal level. A couple folks think we ought to raise it. Where are the folks who think we ought to lower the minimum wage? Lower the minimum wage. Bigger crowd. Now I'm going to have to come back to the guys who think we ought to raise the minimum wage. For Pete's sake, sir, you're going to work your way through school. You're already trying to figure these things out. Clearly, you're a thoughtful guy. Why do you think the minimum wage ought to go up? There's no question. And in fact, you got to be honest about every single one of these debates. If anybody tells you that whatever lobbyist comes into my office, that they're making their pitch, right? I think you ought to do this on energy. I think you ought to do this for children. I think you ought to do this for higher education. I ask them what's the other side going to tell me? What's the other side of the issue? And if folks say, oh, there's no other side of the issue, I'm just right and everybody else is wrong, you can't deal with those folks. Those are not honest brokers. There's always another side of the issue. And the Congressional Budget Office said if we were to raise the minimum wage, we would lift millions of families out of poverty. Millions of families out of poverty if we raise the minimum wage. They also reported that we would eliminate twice that many jobs. So for those lucky few, those families would get raised out of poverty. For the folks who lost their job, those families would be thrust into poverty, right? There's a pendulum that swings in all of these issues. When we think about how to bring jobs back to America, Malad, I don't want a fair fight. I want to beat the stew out of the rest of the world, right? Because I think we work more hours than anybody else does. I think that work ethic matters. I think we're focused on skills. You know, the top 1% of the engineers that China is going to graduate this year outnumber all the engineers combined who will graduate from American universities this year. The top 1% in China is going to outnumber all of us combined. We've got some real issues going forward. I don't want to see dirtier air. I don't think we ought to repeal all of our clean air regs. I don't want to see dirtier water. I don't want to see us repeal all of our clean water regs. I don't want to see dangerous workplace environments or ratty roads or any of those issues. The one thing that we can deal with as Americans is the cost of labor. We raised the cost of labor through that 15.3% payroll tax I talked about that no other country in the world is utilizing. And we raise it through the minimum wage. You get paid what you're worth is the dirty little secret, right? You get paid what you're worth. You're not supposed to be working for minimum wage when you're 25 years old because you're supposed to have developed some other skills that make you more valuable than minimum wage. If I go out and go to Russell Landscaping, one of the biggest landscaping firms in Forsyth County, they're not gonna pay a single person minimum wage because everybody who works for them is more valuable than minimum wage. The minimum wage is not what folks are supposed to live on. It's what's supposed to be that floor that allows you to get in the door. And every single employer I talk to says, Rob, if you were to lower the minimum wage, I would hire more young people. You all are the most unemployed group of young people in the history of the country. Since we began keeping records, not the history of the country, since we began keeping records in the 1960s, we have never had more young people unable to find a job than exists in 2014. And I believe the minimum wage has an impact on that. But I also believe folks who want to raise the minimum wage have a big heart, right? That it's not that their economics may be flawed, but they have a big heart. You got to try to find the merit in what the other side's argument is. Because if you're going to find an agreement, if you're going to find a pathway forward, if you're going to build a common platform, you have to find something that they believe in. Yes, ma'am?
I have a question.
Yes,
ma'am.
The question is, why don't we let the minimum wage rise at the rate of inflation? Why don't we index it? Tie it in and we index it. In my lifetime, we've never indexed the minimum wage. We raise it in fits and starts, right? When I was your age, it was $3.25 an hour, then it jumped to $4.75. You know, it jumps in increments, not indexed. The answer to that is, if you believe that employers are going to take advantage of people and that we have more employees than we do employers, we have more job openings, more job seekers than we do job openings, I can see why you'd want to try to create a floor. But what I'm saying is, if you have that circumstance, if you have more people who are looking for work than can find work, why in the world do you want to make it harder for businesses to hire people? The secret of the minimum wage, or of taxes, or of anything else is businesses don't pay any of those costs, right? You and I as consumers pay those costs. Anybody get the 32-ounce Quick Trip special in the summer? It was 79 cents this past summer? Was that the refill cost? Maybe it was 69 cents this summer. It used to be 39 cents when I first started shopping at QT. It's been going up and up and up. This year I went with the racetrack, free refills all summer long. Anybody do the free refills all summer long? Yeah, oh man, that was a deal. Competition helps us to squeeze those prices out. If you're the best and the brightest, that's what I don't understand. If you are a hard worker, you don't have to be the best and the brightest. Just be diligent. Employers can't let you go. I think that we have two big emotions in this country. I think we have greed and I think we have hate. I think greed is more powerful than hate. We do lots of legislation in Washington to try to get people to change their behavior around hate, right? Who do you dislike? Why don't you want to hire so-and-so? Why can't you make this work? I'm in the camp that greed overwhelms those things, right? I'll hire whoever I need to hire to be as successful as I can possibly be. We could absolutely index it to inflation, but according to the Congressional Budget Office and a string of other economists, again, it's a trade-off. Yes, you would lift some families out of poverty. Yes, you would eliminate some jobs elsewhere. These are all easier conversations to have when the economy's on fire. If you advocate for increasing the minimum wage, best time to do that is when we're having that good economy. The economy always runs in cycles. Trying to do it right now, toughest time. Trying to do it in about 5 years when things are on fire again, going to be the easiest time. I'm going to oppose you when you do it, but we can still work together and try to make that palatable. Anything else on anybody's mind? Next time you had a congressman locked in your auditorium, you want to make sure you get answers to X, Y, and Z. Yes, in the shadows. Yes, ma'am. The question is, why can't the federal government stay out of states' business? of state's business. I prefer the government to stay out of state's business. The reason the government does not stay out of the state's business is because something happens when you elect your member of Congress or your senator, and you walk inside the Beltway, that's our version of 285 up there in D.C., you suddenly think you're the smartest person in the room. And if only the rest of the country is willing to do what I tell them to do, I can make them so very, very happy. That's what happens. I have the lowest, to give you an example, I have the lowest National Rifle Association rating of any Republican in the state of Georgia. Right? I love the Second Amendment. I love hunting. I grew up. I think guns are a cultural thing in the South. But the NRA pushed a bill that said we're going to federalize all concealed carry legislation. We're going to mandate that this is what the states are going to have to do. And I said, that's crazy. You can't love local control on one day and then decide local control is not good enough for yourself on the next day. Either it's a principled issue that you believe communities make better decisions than Washington does, or it's not. Republicans are absolutely guilty of speaking sometimes about local control and other times about passing laws in Washington to make everybody do it the same way. My friends on the Democratic side, equally afflicted with that double talk. You've got to demand it as a voter. And I'll give you one example. I don't know where you guys are on the president's health care bill. You may not have gotten involved in paying health insurance premiums yet. But the president's health care bill passed for one reason and one reason only. And that is that there was a vacuum created. Folks, pre-existing conditions are a big deal. It's tough to get priced out of the insurance marketplace. In Georgia, we had what's called a risk pool to let everybody who couldn't get insurance in the private marketplace go into this risk pool so they could buy insurance that was provided by the state. But we never funded that. So if you had a pre-existing condition in the state of Georgia, you were just out of luck. The president was able to succeed in nationalizing healthcare policy because individual states had failed to meet some needs that citizens had identified. Now, we've got a state legislature, we've got a governor, we've got a constitutional officer in Georgia called the Insurance Commissioner. I thought it was a terrible idea to nationalize federal healthcare policy. In fact, when Newt Gingrich ran the United States Congress in 1996, he and Bill Clinton passed a bill together that abolished pre-existing conditions for every federally regulated plan. But they had the good sense at that time to say, but we're not going to get in the state's business. We'll lead by example at the federal level. We're going to let states do their own thing. Folks got tired of waiting on the states to do their own thing. The president was able to win the American people over to do national policy. Here's the thing. I don't know if they say it anymore. When my mom tried to get me to clean up my room when I was a kid, she'd say, Rob, it's going to take an act of Congress to get you to clean up your room. Is that still a saying? If something's really hard to do, do you say it's going to take an act of Congress to get it done? Or maybe Congress just is ineffective altogether, and so we've changed the nomenclature, and folks say something different these days. Passing an act of Congress is hard. So when we screw something up in Washington, fixing it is really, really hard. Not so at the state level, and Kentucky's a great example. I don't know if anybody has roots in Kentucky. In the 1990s, Kentucky tried to do their own version of the president's health care bill, and it was a disaster. It ran every single insurance company out of the state of Kentucky. They had one left, their Blue Cross Blue Shield provider, who was required by law to stay. They realized that was a terrible mistake. They fixed it and repealed those laws, crafted a new insurance proposal going forward. 2 years later, they had all their insurance companies back. They can move quickly like that. In the United States Congress, we're still collecting an undersea water cable tax that we created to fund the Spanish-American War in the latter part of the 1800s, right? That's still on the books, and we're still collecting it. You're still paying it. If you have a cell phone, you're still paying some of those taxes. It takes us a long time to get things fixed. We've got to get 435 people to agree on it. Local control gives you faster responses to issues, and it allows you to differentiate yourself from other folks. We have the fastest growing movie industry in the country right now. We're second only to Hollywood and New York in terms of who's producing here. Why? Because we changed our local policies to try to attract that business. Alabama didn't, Tennessee didn't, Oregon didn't. We're succeeding because we've prioritized that. Those other states are succeeding in other areas because they prioritize something different. When I screw something up in Washington, it affects 330 million Americans. If we were to mess something up here in Georgia, it would be lousy for all of us, but we'd have 49 other states to look at and try to do something better. I support trying to speak with only one voice on that issue. And if you ever catch me going over that line trying to push federal policy at the expense of local control, I hope you'll send me an email and call me on it, because that is a very important issue to me. I really do trust us to make decisions in ways I don't trust folks on Capitol Hill to do them. Anything else on anybody's mind? Sir?
What is your view on medical
marijuana? I want to say it was Royce, but I'm wrong about that. Was it Royce? Is that right? All right, okay. Legalizing medical marijuana. Here's the thing about marijuana. When I talk to the medical experts, they say, Rob, it's not the THC that's important. It's not the hallucinogenic that's important. It's the other chemicals. And we're great genetic engineers these days, right? Our friends in Colorado have genetically engineered some marijuana that is, I'm told, powerful THC stuff, right? But we have also genetically engineered some marijuana that has virtually no THC in it at all. And in fact, we've extracted all the active ingredients, the non-THC ingredients, that we've put in pill form for some of these kids who are dealing with seizures and haven't found another effective mechanism. I think you gotta put people first. I put freedom first and I put people first. And if I'm a mom or dad, and there's only one opportunity I have to stem my child's pain, what kind of law would you have to prevent me from nurturing my child? Right? It's going to have to be pretty powerful, because I'm going to find a way around it, because I love my child more than I love the law. We have an opportunity to not confuse our war on drugs debate, but to make sure we are getting medicinal products to folks who need them. I support the efforts in Georgia to bring the extract to parents. I've been working with the FDA, where Georgia is actually one of three states, in a pilot project to try to bring those products to market faster. FDA has been a cooperative partner on that. The DEA has been a cooperative partner on that. I want to see us solve the medicinal side of that. What we're going to do about the war on drugs long term, that's hard. I don't know the answer to that. I didn't smoke marijuana growing up. Had it been legal, would I have made a different decision? I don't know, right? I might have. And the research, while it speaks to the addictive properties of marijuana, also it speaks to the hypothalamus development associated with marijuana. And yes, your brains are still getting better every day of the week. I feel some responsibility not to let those brains have anything impair those, though I have failed in many respects in not being able to stop that impairment. The worst thing about the marijuana debate right now is that we have federal laws that say no, and we're ignoring them. Listen, we're run by the majority, at least the majority of the people who show up. If we want to change the law, let's change the law. But until we change the law, we ought to enforce the law. The worst thing that we're doing right now is some folks are still going to jail for behavior in Georgia, where folks in Colorado are making a profit by doing that same behavior. Doesn't make sense to me. I don't value that. The rule of law is supposed to make us all equal under the law. We're not supposed to have to pick and choose jurisdictions to see how the law is going to apply to us. First step in Georgia is going to be succeeding on medicinal marijuana, the extract there. That's going to make a real difference in people's lives. I don't think that's going to cause us to lose the war on drugs. I think it's just going to cause us to take advantage of an opportunity to make a difference in children's lives. I hope that we will do that, and I will continue pushing on the federal level to make sure that we do. Anything else on anybody's mind? Sir?
What are your thoughts on ISIS?
ISIS, man alive. I'm just curious, because we've got two scary things going on right now. I'm curious if whether you have any fear at all, because you're young and invincible, or whether one is scarier than the other. Who has ISIS fears and concerns? ISIS fears and concerns. A couple of folks? Okay. Who has Ebola fears and concerns? A few more folks. If we had the Pentagon with us today, if we had the Joint Chiefs of Staff sitting here on the, well, three of them sitting here on the front row, we'd have to move the gentlemen over. We get all the whole board. they would say, you know what, Rob, we had some good options for dealing with ISIS 2 years ago. We had some ways we could have controlled that spread. And a year ago, we had some things that might work. But today, we have absolutely no good choices whatsoever. And for those young men who are 18 or turning 18, this involves you. Because the only thing that looks like a successful plan that anyone is promulgating involves folks in your age bracket deployed on the ground in Syria and Iraq. That's not an exciting prospect for anyone, right? You folks have grown up in a time of war. Your entire life we've had troops deployed around the globe. But these guys are different because they have a funding stream that no one else has ever had. When we used to worry about Osama bin Laden, we worried about him because he was a multimillionaire in his own right, and he was able to spend those resources to target America. ISIS is exporting black market oil from oil fields that they can control. And price of oil is a little bit down today, thank goodness for all of us in the automotive marketplace. But they're getting about $1 million to $3 million a day in black market oil receipts. They are the best funded terrorist operation we have ever seen, ever seen. ISIS, Islamic State of Iraq and Syria, really artificially constrains their goals, right? ISIL, much more accurate description, Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant. That's that whole former Ottoman Empire stretching down through Lebanon into Israel, across through Jordan. Their designs are not to stop in Iraq and Syria, but to recreate that caliphate, to recreate that footprint of the Ottoman Empire. About 200 of those guys so far that we've identified either have U.S. passports or passports from visa waiver countries, which means they can just wander through Hartsfield International anytime they want to, wouldn't be stopped. We've got about 40 of those guys who have come back and are in the country right now that we're tracking. About 15 of those folks are in jail. But there are others who are running around. I think it's a serious terrorist issue. I think it's the most dangerous terrorist foe that we have faced since September 11th, 2001. Funding being the dominant issue there. We're bombing the stew out of them today with mixed results. We're killing a lot of people. I don't really call that a badge of honor in any way, shape, or form. But the American public is not prepared to send you and your classmates in uniform to Iraq again today. What I would tell you is the sign that we're serious about dealing with ISIL is going to be, number one, when more hands go up that they're concerned about that than Ebola, right? Because it is a different threat. And number two, when those hands go up in a way that requires Congress to declare war for the first time since World War II. It is outrageous to me that your powers as the people is supposed to be with your representatives in Congress, and yet we abdicate the responsibility of dealing with any of these international threats. And we say, you know, Mr. President, whoever you may be, whether it's President Bush, President Obama, President Clinton, who have you, you go and execute these missions. You go and prosecute these missions. We're going to authorize the force, but we're not going to really call this a war. We make bad decisions as a nation when we don't have skin in the game. And if you're an 18-year-old man in this room, you have skin in the game because we might be coming for you. But if you're a 17-year-old woman in this room, you might not have skin in the game. Maybe you're thinking about joining the armed forces. Maybe you've got an older brother, younger brother. Maybe you've got a mom or dad who's in the armed forces. But all across this country, the only people who are involved in a war effort are people who have family members in uniform and at risk. The rest of us, if I ask you, I mean, think about this. Anybody appreciate our men and women in uniform? Are you grateful for the freedom that they provide? I am too. I'm not going to pick on you here, but I'm just going to ask you. Does anyone in this room know how many U.S. servicemen and women died in Afghanistan last week? Does anybody know? Think about that. Here we are. We are grateful for these folks. We do believe that they are on the front lines doing things so that we don't have to. We do believe we can put our head on the pillow at night and rest easy because someone else is there on our behalf, and yet it's just kind of static in the background. The good news is the answer is no servicemen and women died in Afghanistan last week. But we're not focused on it as if it's our battle too. One way you do that is with war taxes. You have the bullet side of war that men and women in uniform are prosecuting, and you have the bread side of war, which is what you and I are doing when they're taking something extra out of our paycheck to go and fund that war effort. I don't think America should be involved in a war unless we're all in together. I think ISIS is going to bring us to a point where we're going to be all in together, but we're not at that point today. And sadly, I think more people are going to have to die before we get to that point. Just as Ebola, right? Folks treated Ebola as if it was a nothing. Now that it's being passed as a contagion, now that folks are dying on American soil, we're getting a little more focused on that than we were just 12 days ago. Anything else in anybody's mind? Yes, ma'am. Ferguson and St. Louis. I wish that I knew more about the truth. And candidly, I don't think many of us know anything about the truth, right? We've got two sides of the story that's being told. Tell me this, because you guys are young and rebellious. I may be the youngest of the United States Congressman from Georgia, but I'm kind of old and tired by 17, 18-year-old standards. Is there any set of circumstances where Forsyth County Sheriff's deputies pull up to you and tell you to get out of the road and you mouth off to them? Is there any set of circumstances where men and women in law enforcement come up to you and tell you to get on the ground, to step out of the way, to do something differently than what you're doing today, and you start arguing with them about whether or not that's the right thing to do and whether or not they're the boss or you're the boss? Something bad is happening in American culture. If we don't have law enforcement that we can trust, then we need to fix that. But if we do have law enforcement that we can trust, and I believe 99 times out of 100 we do, they're the boss of whatever situation they come in to get involved in. And I don't have the right, I'm a United States Congressman. Do you think there's a chance that someone says, Rob, I need you to get out of the car and lie down on the ground, and I start talking to them about me not wanting to get my suit dirty, and why is that the right thing to do? That's outrageous. You have to give law enforcement the deference that they have earned standing there between us and danger every day of the week. If law enforcement can't be trusted, we need to fix it. But the answer is not to decide law enforcement can't be trusted, and so we're just going to ignore them and have a battle of our own. Bad things are happening to young people across this country. I don't want to see anybody get shot. I don't want to see anybody get hurt. But I don't want to see anybody run either. Right? The answer isn't to flee until you can't flee any longer and then shoot until you're out of bullets and then say, dadgummit, somebody should have handled something differently. I am not smart enough or brave enough to second guess a single man or woman in law enforcement. We ask them to do an impossible job every day of the week. What I am smart enough to know is that we have a responsibility as non-law enforcement folks to promote the respect and obedience to those law enforcement officials. And if someone treats you poorly, come to me. We'll sort this out. We'll win a $10 million suit against the county. We'll have you set up for life so you don't have to use any of your potential. You can just sit around and eat bonbons all day long, right? We can do that. If you get wronged, we can do that. But the right place to deal with bad law enforcement is after the fact, not in the fact. And I have a very difficult time making excuses for anybody who decides they know better than that law enforcement official who's standing there in the moment. Lots of time to fix it after the fact. I don't think we should have that debate when that danger is present, when those things are happening. Sir?
Two questions.
Yes, sir.
Cameras on top.
Say again?
Cameras on top. Your opinion on that?
I'm not opposed to cameras on cops. I'm not sure it gets us what we want. But I think we're trying to find a way to get to where we want, and I'm not opposed to having that on the list of options we might choose. That's question number one. What's two?
Net neutrality.
I'm opposed to net neutrality. I'll tell you why. Let me do one more thing on cameras on cops. We have cameras on the floor of the House these days. I serve on the Rules Committee. It was the last committee to get cameras. We just put cameras in 2 years ago because we do. It's a tough committee. We've got to do some tough stuff, and folks didn't want cameras in the room. If there's anyone in this room who believes we have a better government, we have a better debate, we have a better operation in Washington because there are cameras on the floor of the U.S. House of Representatives, I'm going to tell you you're crazy. You're crazy. I'm glad the U.S. House of Representatives has always been open to people. You can always come sit in the gallery. You can always be there. But we have changed, the cameras have changed that chamber from a place where people talk about ideas to a place where folks go and stand up and grandstand. If you ever turn on C-SPAN sometime and see if you think anyone is listening to one another, or if everyone is grandstanding one right after the other, and they do that because of the cameras. I believe that openness and transparency is something that we should always pursue. I do not believe that recording everything that happens gets us to where we want to be ultimately. I just think it's one of those things on the list that we can talk about. Net neutrality is the thing where we say, golly, AT&T has just spent $1 billion laying fiber through Metro Atlanta, and they'd like to be able to stream some of their video material. And they'd like to stream it to you faster. But they have some competitors, Netflix is out there, and can AT&T prioritize AT&T video traffic over Netflix video traffic when it travels across AT&T fiber? I don't know why, if folks are willing to invest in the infrastructure that gets things to you and me faster, that they shouldn't be allowed to determine how they move traffic across that infrastructure. Now, I get the dirty underbelly side, right? Well, we're going to have the defense industrial state is going to take over all the wires, and then we're not going to be able to move dissident traffic, right? I'm not going to be able to speak out. The minority is going to be suppressed. And I recognize the big brother awful outcome at the end of that road. And if we looked like we were going down that road, I would want to have the net neutrality debate again. But today, where we have so many choices, right? I can get it on my iPhone. I can get it on the DSL. I can get it through UVerse. I can bring it in through the cable. I can bring it in through the Wild Blue satellite service. I have so many choices in pipes. I cannot believe that we as consumers are going to be prevented from accessing material we would want to access. It is only when we are being denied access to a free internet that I think the net neutrality debate ripens for that discussion of telling private sector businesses how it is they can and can't use their pipes. Sir? Yes, I am. Student loan bubble bursting. A couple of things about the student loan bubble. It's not fueled by 18 to 22-year-olds. There are as many people in my age bracket borrowing today as there are in your age bracket borrowing today. Whenever the economy goes downhill, folks look at going back to school and retooling. Some of those folks retool in a way that gives them more productivity, better job prospects. Other folks flush that money down a rat hole. The greatest number of student loan defaults as a percentage of the population are men and women over the age of 65. It's not you, it's them. I'm tremendously concerned about that. Two areas of inflation in this country that run rampant above marketplace inflation rates: healthcare and higher education. Two areas in the marketplace where the US government pumps the most money in to subsidize purchasing: healthcare and higher education. In an effort to make sure you are successful, because we need you to be successful, folks want to pump more money into that marketplace. I believe we have inadvertently then inflated that marketplace, made it harder for folks to achieve. I'm tremendously worried about the student loan bubble, not only because these are folks that we need to be successful, but also because generally the reaction from Washington is, let's go bail somebody out. We're out of money to bail people out. The money we borrow to bail people out comes out of your pocketbook and your future. It's your future that we're mortgaging. And I don't want to see us exacerbate that. And again, particularly since we're not bailing out your generation, we're bailing out middle-aged and older Americans who are really responsible for more of that burst. I see Mr. Jimenez coming to talk to me about the hook that's about to come. Is there one last question before I go double dip over here? I didn't want to double dip, miss. I'm going to come to the front row then. Major investments in environmental alternative energies. This is a good place to end. I drive an electric car in Washington. I drive an electric car down here. I do it because I want to do my part. I don't want to legislate that you have to do your part. I just want to try to do my part. That and the federal tax code incentivizes us to move in that direction. If you will work with me to get us to energy independence so that I'm not dependent on people who hate us to provide for our national security needs, I will then commit to you to work on any division of alternative energies that you'd like to work on. Being involved in alternative energy is a moral issue. It's an economic issue. Preserving America's energy independence is a national security issue. North American energy independence would be where I would place that. So I absolutely think there's a place for that. I do not believe that the environment and business are juxtaposed to one another. I think we have a successful economy and a successful environment. But generally, that's not where the regs end up. Generally, we end up over-regulating in a way that damages economic opportunity. Much like the best time to raise the minimum wage is when the economy is on fire, the best time to invest in expensive technologies is when the economy is on fire. When folks can't pay their electric bill today, it's hard to ask folks to pay more. I'll give you one final example of where you might be able to put this into practice. Kilowatt hour here cost me $5 from Georgia Power. Kilowatt hour in Hawaii cost, I'm sorry, 5 cents. Kilowatt hour in Hawaii costs 42 cents because of where they're located and what their infrastructure looks like. We could be transformative here, but why transform Georgia where we have the lowest energy prices in the nation? Why not start with the guys with the highest energy prices in the nation? It would bring more consumer benefits to people faster than a nationwide mandate. I think doing things in a way that we as consumers and taxpayers get the greatest benefit in the fastest period of time, those are the easiest pieces of policy to push forward. University of Georgia doing amazing work in cellulosic ethanol right now. They've just bioengineered the bacteria to convert directly into diesel. It's going to be an amazing gain. I'm counting on you guys because my Social Security check in 35 years again is going to require you all to be paying into the system during all that time. If there's anything I can do to partner with you for your success, please call on me. You've already paid my salary, whether you like my politics or not. I work for you. If you're fighting with the IRS, if you're fighting with immigration, if you're fighting with the VA, if you're fighting with DOD, anything that you're thinking about dealing with the federal government, let me be your advocate. I don't care about your politics either. I care about whether your government is serving you or whether your government is treating you as a servant. And I want to be on the team there. Thank you for letting me come out and visit with you today.
Again, thank you very much for allowing the congressman to come in to speak to you today. 7th District of Georgia representing you guys. You guys have his biography, all the committees that he serves on. If you would like further information, obviously you have